another TSM live show, season 3, episode 2. I'm your host, Tommie Zam. This episode, we're at the Good Bar Eatery in Long Beach, California. We have a great episode. We have interview with Jose Cerda, interview with Ricki Bedenbaugh, music by Loose Trucks, and interview with Shiloh Greathouse. You guys ready to get this show started? In the news and events, Bones Bearing sent over this edit of Derek Williams. You guys ready to check it out? Steve's truck dropped James Martin's part. You guys ready to check it? Because I sure am. May 16th, Empire Skates presents Spring Break Yourself, contest at New York Skate Park. More info coming soon. Booyah! Coming up is Jose Cerda. What's up, buddy? Woo! How you doing, dude?
Yeah, good to see you, man.
Doing good?
Yeah, yeah.
How was your trip up? Because you live right around the corner, don't you?
Yeah, yeah, local.
Where at?
Down the street. Just right up past the college right over here.
Oh, okay. Yeah. All right, definitely, dude.
Yeah, Long Beach.
So you ready to get this started?
Yeah.
All right, so let me ask you a quick question, dude. Why do you love skateboarding so much, dude? Like, what skateboarding do for you?
It gave me a voice, you know, created who I am.
Oh, yeah?
Created my individual self, my character. It's been teaching me a lot through life, yeah.
And you do a lot, like, you say, like, teaching a lot, your life, like, what does it teach you? Like, what has it teach you?
Just to persevere, to keep going, you know? Get some, you know?
Yeah,
so.
And you do a lot of, like, art and music and, like you've done a lot of stuff. I see, like, I see all your stuff on social media. Like, you're
correct.
Killing it, dude.
Yeah.
Like,
yeah, I've been, just been painting a lot lately. Doing, getting in on some shows and different events here and there. I got a show going on next weekend and at the Reno Room. And I have another show, a benefit show that I'm doing for an Australian relief benefit show for the fires that went on out there.
What? That's sick.
Yeah,
dude.
So I'm donating some art for that. So
yeah.
It should be a good event. It's here in Long Beach as well.
And I saw some pictures of like on it, like was it, I think it was this year's or last year's. You did something with like some big music festival, like Coachella or something like that?
Yeah, yeah. In the past I've done a couple of different pieces for the Coachella music festival.
How was that, dude?
Like, it was cool, you know, like the first year that I did it, we painted onto these trash cans and I went out there and it was cool. It's like massive amount of people to your work. And then I got that linked up to a buddy of mine, Ben Bruff, from Volcom. He worked over in the art department along with Ethan Anderson and Marty Jimenez. So I linked up with those cats and they got me a couple different art gigs.
What?
So it's been really cool. Those dudes have really helped me out a lot through their art program at Volcom. They were the first people to do it. Like, even before Ricki was even around, like, Volcom, they had, like, the artist networking program.
How did that feel when you got that phone call? Like, hey, Jose, we want you to be part of this.
You know, it was really cool. I never really had my art displayed to a larger audience of people like that.
Yeah.
So I went out to the event the first year. It was huge. I mean, there's hundreds of thousands of people out to these events. And it was cool. It was nice to see people from all walks see my work.
Yeah. Yeah. Did anybody now notice who you are in your artwork and they come up and get autographs from you or anything like that?
I've been doing some, I did this show here in, what was it, some big reggae event that they had down here and it was through Pops Blue Ribbon.
Uh-huh.
And they hooked that up and got me into another big platform.
What?
It's just about just more people seeing your work, basically.
Yeah.
You're just putting yourself out there and letting people like.
And what got you into the art scene? Like, what got you into all that the artwork and stuff?
So, in high school, I took screen printing class, and I was also in the art classes there at Huntington Beach High School. And basically, through skateboarding, eventually allowed me to create my own skateboard graphics. But I learned all that early on through high school, and I was able to apply that to my later career, down to having professional skateboard models, and getting them all screen printed.
Yeah.
So eventually, like, manufacturing skateboards.
Oh, you do? What company? Who do you manufacture with?
So I've been manufacturing skateboards for the last 25 years.
What? Congratulations, homie.
Yeah. So I actually created this line of boards here.
Yeah.
It's actually a celebration of me.
25 years.
Skateboards for 25 years.
Dude, that's
along
awesome.
With my friend Cholo from Scum Skates, which started this brand 25 years ago.
I remember Scum. Yeah.
So it's just, I did this graphic. It was all done by hand. I did all the film work with paint brushes with Indian ink right onto acetate, which is like this old style of producing art.
Yeah.
It was once before digital.
Before digital,
to create art. And so it was cool. Cholo hit me up and I thought it would be a great opportunity to get into
sick,
creating
dude.
Something that
and you do a lot of stuff with music too, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. So I was fortunate enough to go to shows and meet up with some of the artists at shows, and I talked to them and was able to like create some skateboard graphics as well for a couple different artists to do like band boards and stuff.
So oh, really? What bands have you done
them with? So I did like, actually this band that's going to be playing later on here today, which is Loose Trucks, they were formerly known as Indigents.
Uh-huh.
And so I've also done some other boards for this band called Go Betty Go. And I also was just like painting a bunch of boards for like the stitches and just like different artwork that I would just create on the boards.
Yeah.
Like I went to a show in Anaheim at Alex's bar, and I ran into a band called The Epoxies, and they really inspired me that day from listening to their music. I went home and just started painting a bunch of boards. I found out they're gonna play the following weekend.
What?
In Hollywood.
Uh-huh.
So what I did was every day after work when I came home, I just started painting a different board for each band member because I wanted them to all get some of my work.
Yeah.
Since they inspired me, I wanted to give them a little bit of like the end of, you know, their work.
Yeah.
For inspiring me. So I went out to the show, and it was in it was out in Hollywood, and basically I was able to meet up with the band and give them the boards firsthand.
Were they stoked?
Yeah, man, they were so stoked. It was the end of their tour, so they're like, man, this is the greatest gift I've ever. This is amazing. And actually, I just recently got contacted by Roxy from The Epoxies with one of those boards she posted on Instagram.
Dude, that's sick.
And so I was like, oh, sick. Like, it came back around probably like 10 years later.
Yeah, yeah.
You know? So yeah, I've been manufacturing skateboards for the last 25 years and just doing art and just skating and having a good time and just like enjoying the better parts of life.
Yeah. Hell yeah, that's awesome. And then you do also too, you do like you meet up with a bunch of homies on Saturdays, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I got my crew of buddies that I skate with.
I saw heavy metal
Chuck and my buddy Raul.
Yeah.
And my buddy Roger, and like we got a whole crew, Dave Baskins, like
yeah.
Jason Acuna.
Acuna, I haven't heard that name in a while.
Yeah, yeah, we've been skating. I just skated with Jason yesterday, actually. It was really cool. We've been linking up the last couple of Fridays and skating some spots.
Yeah, we just had him on our show last season.
Oh, yeah?
Hey, he killed it, dude. I saw the edit of you, man, like cruising down that little ditch. Where's that ditch at?
It's like out towards, like, out in LA, East LA.
Is that something that
yeah, it's kind of low-key, but low-key? It's sick.
Looks sick, dude.
Some dude built it, like added some stuff onto something that was already existing there.
Uh-huh.
Just like a real, almost like a surf skate spot.
It really looks cool. Sick, dude, because I mean, you were like carving like that and everything.
Yeah, it was a lot of fun. Yeah.
And what's going on? You got anything new coming up or anything?
Yeah,
or?
So I have a show going on, those two shows I was telling you about. I'm also going to have... I'm going to be flying out to Germany in July for a show that I've been out there for the last 2 years.
Tell me about this.
Yeah, so I've been doing this show at a museum out there for the last 2 years with another skater friend of mine, that Christian. They came out, and I met up with him, and we just skated and did art and stuff together, and he's been doing this show out there. So this year I'm actually going to physically be there. Enjoy the show myself, so pretty stoked.
Pretty stoked. When you leave for that?
That's in July.
July, huh?
Yeah.
So you hear that, Germany? Come look out, Jose, man, in July. Look for his artwork, dude. So do you have like what's your most memorable thing about skateboarding to you?
Oh man, so many. Just like
one thing that sticks out to your mind about what's the most memorable thing about skateboarding to you?
San Francisco, skating down the hills with like Shugi and doing power slides down the hills, like front side and back side, where you slide like that, you slide like that, and like just sliding, going fast, and just like, and I just remember like, I skated for Spitfire at the time, and our wheels went from this big
to that
at the bottom of the hill, your wheels were like pinner.
Oh shit.
And like, so you would just keep sliding and stuff. And yeah, so Steve Shugi, like, he's the boss out there. He's like, so stoked, just skating with all those guys, Joey Trochet and like all those dudes up north. Like,
yeah, yeah. And
so, amazing time. So
you also rode for Milk too, right?
Yeah.
How was that?
It was cool. It was cool. I never would have thought that I just skated because I wanted to skate. I never knew where skateboarding was going to take me. And, through just perseverance and just keep doing it, man, like, just skating, you know, it came back to me, and I was fortunate enough to get on the Hosoi's brand. Christian actually came to me and put me onto his skate brand, and from there, skateboarding went global for me. Yeah, it allowed me to travel the world and see different parts of the world.
And think about it. I mean, skateboarding has helped, like, gave you so much love, like art, your art and music and doing what you're doing now. I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, you're coming from like when you were just skating for fun and not just didn't worry about sponsorship, but then all of a sudden now all that brought you to where you are doing now. I mean, that's amazing.
Yeah, I think the important key is to just skate. You know, it doesn't really matter. Like, whether you're a professional skateboarder or you're some skater that just works at Home Depot or anywhere and still enjoy skateboarding, that's all that matters. The skateboarding just gives, like, so you need to just, like, take whatever it gives you. And so you're gonna get the same feeling from skateboarding whether you're sponsored and hooked up or just skating and being just like a normal dude. Like, skating is amazing in any platform that you're, so set your goals on skating, really. Have fun and enjoy
And music. So what kind of music you listen to before you go skateboarding?
You know what? We mix it up a lot. We listen to a lot of, like, new wave music and, like,
like new wave, like what kind of, like?
Old school new wave, like 80s music and stuff. Like
old Smiths?
Yeah. You know what? Like, we'll be skidding around and we'll be like, half of the time we'll just be like, dude, how do you dance to this? Like, we'll just be dancing, like, not even
skating. Are you dancing on your board?
Like, yeah. So we're just having fun, man. Like,
and so you listen more like new wave stuff like that and everything?
Some punk rock music.
And what's your favorite punk rock?
I've been listening to, lately, it's not really punk rock. Let's see, it was...
You can pull it out. You got to look it on YouTube?
No, I mean, we were just listening to Operation Ivy.
Oh.
I just rolled up before I got here. I went to Shiloh's house and skated his mini ramp. We're listening to Operation Ivy on the deck, you know. It was sick. Just like, I haven't skated a mini ramp in a while. We just pretty much been skating like street a lot. Like, But it was cool to skate his mini ramp and like go around and get
some turns in,
you know, like, pretty awesome.
Dude, I'm so happy for you. Like, everything's going good for you, man. Like, art, music, and everything. And one last question. Where can people find your art? Where can they buy it? Where can they, you know, get your artwork if they want to get it from you?
Well, you can find me on Instagram. It's tinyavenger67.
And then, like, are you selling it, or are you, like, can they buy it from you and stuff like that, or?
Yeah. Just send me a message, you know.
Hear that, guys. DM them on Instagram.
Yeah.
Definitely. Hell yeah, dude. Well, thanks for coming on, dude.
Good to see you, bud.
I'm so happy for you, dude. You killed it,
right,
dude.
On,
definitely. So coming up next is Ricki Bedenbaugh. Ricki, How you doing, brother?
The man.
Thank you for coming on, dude. Yeah. What, been like, what, 6 years since we finally got you on here? Something like that?
Probably something like that. I blew it on the first time, but I'm here now, so.
And you live close by, don't you?
Yeah, like about 5 miles away, okay. Right by the airport.
So when you moved to California, you lived in San Diego and then moved to Long Beach?
I originally moved here in 91, tried filming skating, like filming for 101. Nautis basically was like, we'll pay you $10 an hour to film Kris Markovich.
Yeah.
Because he's the homie from Pensacola.
Yeah.
You know what's up.
Yep.
And I was like, all right. And Kris was like, just write down, like, we went out filming, we'd go and watch a fucking movie or something.
What movie would y'all watch, you remember?
I can't remember. So Kris's family, like, they're the ones that, like, hooked it all up for me. Like, they're like, come out, you can live with us. They're like my other family, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
And I started filming Kris. But then after about 6 months of living with them and in their house, I kind of felt bad for, like, not really paying rent, not really being able to afford to, like, do anything but, like, basically put food in my mouth.
Yeah, and yeah.
I told Kris, I'm like, dude, I'm moving back. I'm going back to Florida. Like, I feel bad. He wasn't bummed or anything. He's like, he understood. So, yeah. Lived there for 3 years back in Florida.
And that was when you moved in on 9th Avenue, right? In that 9th Avenue house? I remember that house.
Yeah, yeah. No, not 9th Avenue. Well, there was.
Was it Creighton?
There was Knowles Avenue, and then there was.
What was that one by 7-Eleven?
Savannies. East Savannies. Yeah.
Savannies. I remember that house, dude.
3101 East Savannies. That was the fucking.
We used to go skate Souter.
Fuck yeah.
And then go hit the Savannies house.
That was the fucking party house every weekend.
What was the craziest memory you had there? The one memory you had at Savannies house?
The hurricane.
Oh, I remember that one.
There was a hurricane that hit Florida, and, you know, I was working. I came home. I left all my windows down because the weather was nice. Next morning, woke up, hurricane, whole inside of my car. Like, dude, that much water. The Crown Vic.
Crown Vic, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember that thing.
Yeah, yeah. That was the Whole Wheels. It was like the Hot Wheels logo, but I took out the T and it just said Whole Wheels. And then that next day, me and Volpe and, like, all these guys, like, we just, like, drove around Pensacola and, like, just drank beer and filmed stupid shit, like, yeah.
And that's where you became, where you started getting into filming,
yeah, because
right?
Kris, I came out to California to, like, visit Kris.
Yeah.
He was basically riding for Prime at the time, and then he's like, here, take this camera back with you, and you can kind of, like, figure it out. Like, it had a fisheye on, which I never had. Like, I never had a fisheye. And then I would just film, like, dumb shit, like, me and the friends and the homies just kind of, like, doing stupid shit, like, doing dumb skits and stuff like that, and then...
What's one of the skits you remember?
There was one where there was, like, this, you know, the, like, during Christmas time, they have, like, the plastic, like, what the fuck's the word?
Yeah, I know
whatever,
what you're talking about. Yeah, 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 I know what you're talking about.
There's, like, the baby Jesus and,
oh,
like,
Nativity, whatever.
Nativity, yeah. So I took one of those... And I was, like, dressed up like some, I don't know, some gangster or something. And I was like, yo, I heard this fucking fool's been talking shit on me. We're going to have to fucking put a cap on that fool. Like, whatever. It was, I mean, dude, I was in my early 20s. So me and Keith, like, filmed this skit. And I'm like, there he is right there. So I got on the hood of my, or Keith got on the hood of my car, and we're right there where Sunbank was, that parking lot across the street.
Where we used to skate, the manual
pad. Yeah, exactly. And I'm like, get him! And Keith's filming this way, and all of a sudden the camera cuts this way, and the dude's just sitting in the middle of the street. And I run him over, and, like, I don't know.
Oh, I think I remember that video.
I mean,
I remember that little skit thing, dude.
It was stupid, but
it was
when
awesome.
You're in your, like, early 20s, it was...
Well, you gotta think back in Pensacola, it was different.
As fuck.
There was, like, nothing to do.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, you remember how skateboarding was in Pensacola. Well, what was it like to you? I mean, skateboarding in Pensacola.
I mean, that's, dude, the day I moved to Pensacola, because I'm from Memphis, but I moved to Pensacola, that's when I, like, really started skating. Like, we live in this trailer park off Palafox, and me and my brother just kind of, like, because my older brother skated as well, but he, like, he progressed so much faster than I did, and we found this, like, janky-ass launch ramp because there was this other kid, Poser John, that was the name that we gave him. He built this, like, little kicker.
Yeah.
It might have been about this height, it might have been a little bit lower, but it was like a launch ramp.
Yeah, yeah.
And I had never like skated a ramp or anything at that time. So my brother's like, if you do it, I'll do it. So yeah. I'm like, okay, push, push, push. And I did the full like wing out, boosh, like hit the fucking ground so hard. And my brother just dying laughing, whatever. Yeah. But then he ended up doing it. We both kind of figured it out. And then like through skateboarding, I met DJ Roberts.
Yeah.
You know DJ. Went to Woodham High School. I had like this picture of Jesse Martinez. It was like the cover of a Thrasher, and he was like, "Oh, is that the new Thrasher?" I'm like, "No, I just got it at No Limits." And he's like, "You skate?" I'm like, "Yeah." He's like, "So do I." And he's like, "Steve Caballero is my uncle."
No way. Like, I didn't even know that.
Shut up. I'm like, "You're fucking lying."
Have you asked Steve that? Have you asked Caballero?
Dude, he was full of shit. Of course. He was just doing that to impress me.
Oh, okay.
So.
I was about to say, I didn't know that.
No, not at all. I mean, I still give him shit for him now. But
yeah, yeah.
I'm like, dude, I talked to Cab and I told him that story. Yeah. Like, my buddy that I grew up skating with, like, told me you were his uncle, and he just laughed about it. But, like, growing up with, like, him and Keith, and, like, we all kind of, like, started skating around the same time, so we all kind of, like, I mean, every weekend we were at Keith's house, like, skating his mini ramp. And
that's when you met Arthur Adams, right?
I think I met him at the Y.
At the Y? At the Myrtle Grove?
It was Myrtle Grove, and then there was the Langley Y.
Langley Y, yeah.
And I think he skated Langley Y more than he did Myrtle Grove.
Yeah, because he was more with the Zorlak guys.
Yeah. He skated Vert, and like they had the little spine ramp at Langley, so I believe I met him there. And then, I mean, Pensacola is such a small town. Yeah. Like, anybody that knew came in, you know, we would always skate downtown. And, like, Dave Volpe, like, he was from Chicago, and was like, oh. He's like, yeah, I just moved here. I'm like, fuck yeah, dude, that's so rad. And then obviously met Markovich through skating, and you know.
I think when I first met you was at Myrtle Grove. It was my very first contest ever. It was a Turkey Grove.
Okay, yeah.
That Hudson used to put on.
Yeah. And the first contest I skated ever was the Turkey Shoot.
Yeah, Turkey Shoot, that's what it was.
But that was at the Mariner Mall.
When I skated was the Myrtle Grove one.
Well, yeah, but they've been doing it for
years. Yeah. But that was when I first skated, and I remember that. And that was my first, and I was like, first started skating kind of in the beginning, and I was horrible. But I remember meeting you and watching you skate, killing that wall ride, dude. You're like king on that wall ride,
dude. Dude, they gave us like free rate. Like, Myrtle Grove was like, we'll supply all the wood. You guys can build whatever you want.
Yeah.
Like, to me, Danny, Rawson, DJ, Keith, like, they basically left it up to us to build whatever we wanted. And what we got inspired by was the H Street video when they went to skate camp.
Oh,
like, Danny Way, Matt Hensley, all those guys skated. So we built a wall ride like that. And we built, like, the fun box with the two little, like...
The one on the, I know what you're talking about.
It's like little PVC, whatever, like little rails going down. So we watched that video and was like, we want that, and we figured out how to build it. It was like DIY, kind of before, but not really before, but basically the why was like, here's all the wood.
Yeah.
You guys build whatever you want. Yeah. We don't know anything about building skate parks, but you guys do. So. Yeah.
I mean, that's awesome about that. And then now you do a lot of filming.
Yeah. I mean, that's, so, I mean, that's awesome. I picked it all up in Florida filming the homies, and... Like I said, Kris invited me out, and I filmed with him, and then he introduced me to, like, Rob Dyrdek and, like, all these other, like, people, and then I would film with them, and then I would film with other people, and other people, and other people. So it kind of, like, just snowballed into, like, a career, basically because of Kris. Like, because he rode for Duff. He's like, we need to hire Ricki. Because I was working at Target, dude. And Kris is like...
The one in Point Loma, or...?
No, one in...
Encinitas?
Encinitas.
Okay.
Yeah. And he's like, did you move to California to work at Target? I'm like, no, but I got to pay bills, so...
Yeah.
He's like, dude, I'm going to get you a job at Duff's.
Yeah.
And then I made Wonder Years. And then Giant and 4-1 basically were like, hey, we want you to work for us. So I'm like, all right, fuck yeah, let's do this.
Yeah.
So I started working for, like, New Deal, 7-Year Glitch, and 4-1. And then... 4-1 went under, Element picked me up, and then I started working for Stance.
Yeah.
Etnies.
Etnies, and then you filmed a footage for Ryan Shekler, right?
Well, yeah, yeah.
How was that, dude?
With, like, Red Bull, Sheckler sessions. Dude, Sheckler's a homie. Like, when I went down and fractured my skull, like, dude, the Sheckler Foundation, like, had my back. They basically, like...
And that's where you started kick push.
Keep on pushing.
Yeah, keep on pushing.
There's actually a board here in the bar. Is it time to...
Yeah. That's pretty sick, dude.
Yeah, yeah. There's one somewhere over there.
Somewhere over that way.
5 minutes?
Yeah.
But yeah, so now I'm working for Fox Racing and filming motocross, which I don't really know much about.
Yeah, yeah.
But I like filming it. It's cool.
So tell me about Fox Racing.
It's cool. I mean...
Compared to... Because you went from skateboarding to now...
I still film skating, but just not as...
Much as you are with Fox Racing. So how is that? Tell me about that.
It's different, man, because I don't know much about the sport, but I've like learned over the past 3 years a lot about it, and all the riders are like super cool, and it's just different than filming skating, you know. But skating's my life, so I like it's always
right there.
Yeah.
And you do this hill flip challenge thing. Tell us about that.
The Long Beach Heads. Tender Mutants? Yeah.
Tell me about, how did you start that up?
It's just a random thing at Cherry Park. Like, I think it was probably 10 years ago. Might even have been longer, I don't know. But it's like every year, end of the year, New Year's Eve day, we all meet up, and everybody has to do a hill flip, one after another. If somebody fucks up, start all over.
Yeah. Like, that's pretty awesome you do that.
Can you guys edit this?
Yeah.
So this is that like live broadcast, right? Because they're like looking at us like, hey, you got 5 minutes, so you can cut all this shit out, right?
Yeah.
All right. I feel like I'm being rushed. I'm like, okay.
No. You're good. But
know he's what? Like 5 more minutes.
Well, you know what? We might end up leaving it.
Huh?
We might just leave it as a comedy thing.
But yeah, I could tell a story about something that happened in Mexico, but it will take too long.
Tell me about it. Let's hear about this Mexico thing.
Long story short, in Mexico on a Fox Racing, Shift MX shoot, we drive to basically outside of Tequila, Mexico. I get out of the van, I go take a piss, doing my pants, right? Set my camera up, I feel something in my belt line. I'm like, what the fuck is that? So I kind of like look, and all of a sudden something bites me on my balls. And I'm like, what the fuck? And I pull my pants down and I look, and there's a fucking spider like that big.
What?
In the crotch of my underwear.
Oh,
and it bit
shit.
Me like right where your dick meets your balls.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, what the fuck? Oh my God, I just got bit in the balls by a fucking spider. And we're in this two-horse town in Mexico. I don't know what the fuck's going on. And dude.
Do you know what kind of spider it was?
I was fine, but it just, like, full panic mode.
Did I tell you what kind of spider it was?
No, because they didn't see it. Only I saw it, because it was in my underwear.
Was it big?
Yeah, dude, it was, like, that big. Like, big enough to fucking scare the...
How did
it fucking
get that? Were you in shorts?
I don't know. I have no idea.
You have no idea?
No idea. Unless it was in the van, and when I got up out of the... Because it took 2 hours to get to where we were going, so it could have like crawled in.
Yeah, yeah.
And when I went to pee, it like was like, oh fuck, what the fuck?
It was like, what the fuck's this? It
bit me, dude.
So you got three balls, basically.
No. It did swell up like a bee sting, though.
Oh, it did?
But that scared the shit out, because I didn't know if it was poisonous. I didn't know if I was hurt.
So let me ask you, are you going to do anything film? Have they asked you to do Olympics yet? Film for Olympics, or are you going to be doing that?
I thought that they were. I'm doing Vance Park Series again this year, and that's like 3 stops. And then I thought that I might get hit up to do like the live broadcast of the Olympics, but if I haven't heard anything yet, I don't think it's going to happen.
So what's your feel about this whole thing, the whole Olympics and the whole thing? Your honest opinion.
Hey, dude, honestly, I'm all for it, man.
All for it?
I look at it this way. Like, some people are like, fuck that, it's a core thing. But I look at it this way, like, there's going to be some young kid that's watching the Olympics for something else, and all of a sudden skateboarding comes on, and he's living in fucking wherever, and he's like, whoa, this is rad. Yeah. And then I want to do that.
Yeah.
And then you got another skateboarder. So it's going to open the eyes to a lot of people that have never seen skateboarding.
Yeah.
Not at that level, like, not at, like, Nige's level, like... I feel like the Olympics are only going to like push skateboarding even more than it already is.
Yeah.
Like, I'm not a hater at
all. I mean, what I heard about it is, like, I guess it's only like you got to earn points to get in. Not a lot of countries.
See, I don't know.
Like, a lot of countries are not getting in it.
Well, because they.
I'm like, that's not. To me, that's like, it should be everybody getting in it. You know what I mean? Give everybody
I get
a chance.
It. But at the same time, it's like.
But I do agree with you, what you said. I mean,
it's like when the Olympics like did basketball, uh-huh. and it was like Jordan and like all these like all star dudes. It's like, how the fuck are we gonna win against these dudes?
Yeah.
Like these dudes, like Team USA basketball was insane because it was all these like legends,
like Jordan.
Yeah.
Like everybody.
I don't remember who. It
was, I remember. I remember it's Jordan.
I'm pretty sure he was part of the Olympics.
Oh, and then. But yeah, it was crazy that now other countries built their team to kind of beat them in the U.S. and everything. So it was,
yeah. So I mean, think about. I guess if you looked at skateboarding that way, it's kind of the same way. But because you know, Japan's got a lot of rad skaters.
Oh, Brazil.
Brazil's got a fucking shit ton of rad skaters. U.S. like.
Yeah.
I mean, sure, there's going to be these small little things, but whatever. You should be stoked that you're a part of this.
Yeah.
Like.
I think it's rad.
Even if you don't make it, you still got to like. The opportunity to be a part of it, you know?
I think it's awesome. I mean, my opinion on it is pretty cool because it's like, it kind of like introduces, like you said, skateboarding to other people who don't know
exactly.
about it.
And it's going to be televised. Like, but, everybody's going to see this shit.
But I wonder how it's going to be when you film on the streets with skaters. Like, are they going to, okay, are you filming for Olympics and Harry get the pass?
No.
You still think it's going to be
still
like.
You're going to get kicked out of every spot. Like, I don't give a shit if you're in the Olympics or not. You can't be fucking skating here. Like.
And what's your most memorable thing of filming? What is your one thing that sticks to your mind about filming? It could be anything, motocross, skateboarding, surfing, anything that you done. Like, what's the most favorite thing that you do?
Favorite thing?
Yeah, favorite thing that you ever filmed that's memorable to you.
Well, one of the most favorite things I've ever filmed that actually got erased because I accidentally recorded over it. I talked about this 100 times, but Markovich. Rhode Island.
Oh, yeah.
Ollied over this thing, landed on the back of a delivery truck, ollied up the front of the delivery truck. He told me, like, this is the best thing you've ever filmed. And to hear that from him, somebody that I looked up to and somebody that's, like, kind of, like, taught me how to film skating, like, that meant so much.
Yeah.
And then, like, everybody, of course, they heard him say that, and everybody wanted to see it, so I'm like, yeah, check it out. Last person basically watched it till right when he landed on the back of the truck. I was like, oh, that's cool. And I didn't check to look for the hand.
Oh.
So we went to New York. Chris is like, you want to go cruise around? I'm like, yeah, I'm down. And I'm like, oh, shit. My first time in New York. I'm like, look, it's Radio City Music Hall. And I started filming it. We get back to the hotel, and Chris is like, hey, let me check out that ollie again.
Yeah.
I'm like, all right. And I'm like, this is like high 8 days. I'm like looking through the eyepiece, and I see him ollie, and right when he lands, it cuts to radio, like the Radio City Music Hall at night. And I look at him, I'm all, dude, it got recorded over. And he's like, so it was like the best thing I filmed, but the worst situation ever. Like, dude, I will never forget that moment because the look on his face was just like, he was devastated. And then Lance Dawes shot the photo. And the photo's so rad. It was like two-page spread and slap.
Oh,
there was like
I remember that photo.
Skeleton in the foreground, and Chris is like ollieing. Dude, it was so gnarly.
Dude, that's awesome. Well, you know, I got a special guest for you.
Yeah?
Yeah. Hey, let's bring on a special guest. You ready for it? Hold on, Eric is coming. Special guest coming.
Are you sure?
I think they're coming. Special guest.
Shut the fuck up. Oh, dude.
How are you?
Hey, speak of the devil.
I know, speak of the devil. How you doing, buddy? Good seeing you, man. Hell yeah. So we were just talking about his most memorable film thing that he remembers, and the thing was in New York.
No, Rhode Island.
My bad, Rhode Island. Sorry about that. Old age.
I already knew that was coming.
Dude, I will never forget that day. I bring that up so much, like so much. I feel I will never, ever.
Why? We had the photos.
I know, dude. I just felt so bad.
That's you. I never.
Oh, here. I guess you wanted me to hold this. Oh. You talk. And now I talk, and then you talk.
I didn't care. You were the one who was bummed. I never cared.
Okay.
I cared in the van.
I love this.
I cared.
You cared in the hotel. No. So I showed him the footage, right?
Yeah.
And he, dude. He like looks at me, he's like, I show him the footage.
I would have done it again. That's the reason. I would have done it again if he would have looked.
But I didn't know.
I know. Now you gotta go back and do it.
He looks at me and he's all, don't fucking talk to me. And just slams the door. I'm like, I sat there and I just was like, you know the guy from Boogie Nights when he's all, I'm a fucking idiot. I'm a fucking idiot. That was me. Like, I was like, dude.
Yeah, you were fucking salty for a few days after that. For a while.
You told me that clip was like the best thing I ever filmed. So that meant so much to me. And then I fucking blew it.
You know he's living with that for the rest of his life, you know?
Still.
He's going to have the tattoo on his arm.
Well, because now, I mean, it's different now, but now I always check the footage. Like, well, after that, I always like made sure that when somebody watched it, that it was queued up back to the hand and not...
That's good.
Lesson learned.
So I got you on. This is the last question. And I asked you this question, so now I got you both of you guys here. What is your best memorable trip to California? From Pensacola to Pensacola?
Hands down.
Now, remember I asked that question last episode? On
the
your
first
episode.
Time.
Like, tell me the best story of you two's trip.
We don't have a half an hour because that's how long I'm going to talk for. Like,
yeah.
I want to hear the best story.
Okay. He's quiet.
I'm just trying to figure out what the fuck story.
The fucking neck one.
Oh, yeah, but which part? That's the thing. Like,
the whole part.
Oh, shit. All right, go ahead.
Okay, just break it down, like, in 2 minutes.
2 minutes.
Well, it was the first time. I turned 19. I just bought the car, that Honda Civic.
It was 91.
Yeah. And we drove back for the Houston contest, Shut Up and Skate contest. Yeah. But we drove across country back to Pensacola and stayed there for a couple weeks. Then went to Houston. And then we were there for the contest. We saw Nirvana play. And then I don't remember. Then, I don't remember very much about that part of the trip.
Bill Weiss got naked and got kicked out of the bar. Like, I remember, like, Nirvana playing. This is, like, right when they were, like, kind of.
Yeah.
Nevermind, it just came out. Bill Weiss got naked in the bar. I'm sitting there watching Nirvana play, and Tony Hawk's sitting right there. I'm like, that's fucking Tony Hawk. That's Nirvana, and there's a naked man that's fucking running through the fucking bar. And I think you might have gotten into like a skirt. You didn't get into a fight that night, did you?
No.
That was when I first came back to California. Oh.
Yeah,
that,
no,
you
would want a dance contest.
Yeah,
that
I
want
a dance contest and some guy
would have
fight me.
Hold on, someone would have fight you.
What
was that?
It was like when I came here to visit Chris to try to find a job. Sorry. Try to find a job. And we went to this, like, he had just got back from Hawaii, and we went to this, like, I don't know, some bar party thing.
Dana Point,
yeah.
Yeah.
I was wearing a wife beater that just said wife beater on it. And I got up on stage and started dancing to this like disco thing or whatever, and then this guy got pissed at me because I got second place. I didn't even know there was a contest. Like, but I won some gift certificate to this restaurant, and the guy's all, "Who the fuck do you think you are? And Chris is like, "What?" And he just fucking headbutts a dude, and then they full on like brawl out the bar, and this is my first moment with Chris in years, because he was in Hawaii. I don't know.
Yeah, the dude was pissed that you were dancing. He wasn't happy, and he was
There's too many good memories.
I know there's a lot of good stories.
I mean, I literally could go on.
We can do a whole episode of just you guys' stories.
I swear to God, we could.
Definitely good story. Well, good guys, thanks for coming on the show.
Of course.
Thank you so much, dude. Thank you so much. And you guys killing it. I'm proud of you, man.
I'm proud of you.
I'm proud of
Look
you.
Look at this.
Yeah, and I'm proud of you, man. Like, and you, too. I'm proud of both of you guys, dude.
And a fucking quarter pipe.
I know.
Who are you going to give this to?
Cherry Park.
Rob G says he wants it.
Rob G does?
Rob G says he wants it.
All right.
He's somewhere over there.
He's over there. All right, Rob G. Well, thanks for guys for coming on.
Of course.
And you guys ready to check out Loose Trucks?
Fuck yeah.
All right, coming
are
up
they
next.
They playing next?
Yeah, playing next. All right, you guys ready here at Loose Trucks? Up next. Thanks, homie. We'll be right back. Let's bring on Shiloh Greathouse.
Woo-hoo!
Yeah. What's up, brother? How you doing?
Good, man.
Thanks for coming on.
You're welcome.
So you live around the corner, don't you?
Yeah, you know, a funny thing, this street right outside the bar, Coronado, I used to actually, like, 9 years ago, I lived on that street.
Oh, really?
Before this was the good bar.
Really? What was it before this?
It was some, like, little dive bar. I think it was called, like, the Bull Bar or something.
Okay.
It's funny. I was just talking about that with somebody, and I remember walking in here back when I lived there, and it was just, like, dark, and there was, like, you know, five people that were, like, sinking into the bar, sitting in the bar, I took a mental note of the people, you know, because then like a month later I came in, it was like the exact same people in the exact same spot. So, it was run down. Like, Blake hooked this place up.
Yeah, definitely. It's like a legendary skate bar now, you know what I mean?
For sure.
Everybody.
It's like the skate bar.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And, you know, any bar should I open up, try to copy this? It can't. You know what I mean?
No.
So, you ready to get in this interview?
Yeah.
Well, how you been, dude? Like, everything going good? Like, what's new with you, or?
I mean, not much, you know. Time just goes by, but I'm definitely good. I'm great, you know.
Well, the first question I'm gonna ask you is, what made you skateboard? Why do you love skateboarding so much?
Well, that's two questions.
Yeah, it's two questions. Yeah, it's two questions. two questions in one.
Well, okay, to start, what got me into skateboarding?
Yes.
Before I skated, I was heavily into BMX racing.
You?
Yeah, like super into BMX racing. Now, if you remember that movie Rad?
Yeah.
So like, so Rad came out. I think Rad came out in 84 maybe.
Yeah, I think it was
actually,
right.
I had already started getting into skating when Rad came out. But I was still really into BMX racing. There was a track, just like a DIY dirt track, like a legit track that like older kids built that was up in the hills from my neighborhood called the O Track. And we used to always go to, this is Glassell Park, right? So we used to always, the neighborhood kids would always go race that track. And I remember seeing like some other older kids in the neighborhood skateboarding around, you know? And no ollies or anything yet. This was like pre-ollie, you know, street ollie. And like, just like kind of here, like riding off curb cuts and whatever. And I was like, oh, that looks super, you know, that looks like a lot of fun, right? And I don't remember ever not having a skateboard as a kid. There was always like the little banana board.
Yeah.
You know, it was like a toy.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like, and I remember I used to always like do tic tacs and like try to do 360s on my porch with a little banana board. And then until I saw like, you know, somebody riding a wide professional skateboard at the time, right? And I was like, whoa, that's so crazy. Just seeing a big fat skateboard with big wheels and like, it was just so, it was not what I pictured of a skateboard, you know?
Yeah.
Because skateboards were those little banana boards, right? So I was really intrigued by it for the longest time. Until finally one day, I was on my way home from school and I saw that same dude. He happened to end up being an older brother of another kid that I went to elementary school with.
Okay.
So I went up and started talking to him about it. He was letting me check his board out. I remember it was a Vision Gator.
Oh,
like, and I remember checking the board out and I was being all like just super, super psyched on it. I remember it had Indies on it. It had green bones three wheels.
Ooh,
it was a green and black, you know, the Vertigo.
And it had the grip nose and like grip.
No, no, it didn't have.
You know,
like nose guard and all that.
No, no.
It didn't have a nose guard or a skid plate.
Okay.
This dude like already kind of knew what was up.
Okay.
Like the posers had that shit.
Yeah, yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And I remember that the dude telling me like, he's like, oh, I just got a new board. I'll sell you this board.
Yeah.
Right? And I remember buying, so I bought this complete setup off him.
You're like this, like, damn.
No, I went home and like told my mom, like, oh, I want to buy the skateboard, whatever.
Yeah.
And I ended up buying off him. I want to say it was like really cheap. Like he sold me the whole setup for like $15 or something.
Yeah.
Dirt cheap. Like, you know, compared to even back then, the price of the skateboards, right? And so I had this board. So now I'm still riding BMX, but I would like roll in the front of my house, you know, up and down my block on my skateboard by myself, because none of my friends skated yet.
They're
all still BMXers. And I remember the first thing I learned to do was little crack bump ollies, you know what I mean? Where you like lift and bump off the crack. So there was a crack right in front of my house. It was like literally in front of my walkway.
Yeah.
And I would just roll back and forth and always bump little crack ollies off of that thing.
Yeah.
And that's kind of like what really got me Like just that feeling the board hot and like land.
Because when you hit those cracks.
Yeah. You and it was a big one too. And you know, those Power Bone three wheels are like massive. Yeah, yeah. They're like big marshmallows.
Yeah, yeah.
So I mean, it was like, and you know, little, the kid, the board weighed like as much as I did.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like I was a little, I gotta say, like, I must have been like maybe seven or eight. Maybe eight.
Yeah.
Anyway, so that feeling like got me hooked. That feeling of like the weightlessness and coming back down, like just bumping off that thing. And then so from there I started like dropping off curbs. And like, you know, I would take my skateboard everywhere with me and I'd drop off like benches, you know, like I guess that was acid drops back in the day.
Back
like rolling
in the
off stuff. Bill Danforth, you know, signature trick.
See, I used to try to do the hospital.
What was the hospital again?
Well, where you put your 2 feet. Like, you have 1 foot right here on the tail, and you have the other foot on there, and you grab it, and you try to flip between your legs.
Oh, yeah.
I tried to do that.
Yeah.
I couldn't do
that. Yeah, that's...
I couldn't do that one.
Yeah. I still wouldn't do that one. But, so that, you know, I just progressed with that, and then, like, slowly BMX started to fade away, and I was, instead of riding my bike, I'd be riding my skateboard around. Yes. And then, I want to say, what was... Not thrashing, maybe thrashing came out. I think I was already skating. I could already like ollie when thrashing came out. But a lot skateboarding was starting to grow in popularity, like in the neighborhood.
Yeah, that was like mid '80s or
mid '80s. Yeah, okay. And I didn't know at the time. I hadn't seen any videos, but I know that like Future Primitive had already been out. I just never saw it. I didn't know about it. Future Primitive, then what was the one after that? There was Bones Brigade Video Show, Future Primitive, right?
Yeah.
And then, well...
There's so many POW videos.
Yeah, so Search for Animal Chin. That was my first skate video.
Because Primitive, wait, when was the one Ray Barbie did all the...
That's Public Domain.
Public Domain,
yeah,
okay.
That's
that was my classic favorite one.
Yeah,
that's all my favorite
one. Definitely, forever.
Yeah.
But Search for Animal Chin came out. Uh-huh. And that was the first skate video I first saw.
Yeah.
You know, before, but I already knew at that point. Like, I could already like ollie, and I could jump, like do methods and all kinds of stuff. Yeah. We're already building jump ramps. Building jump ramps and stuff by that time. But yeah, like I said, what made me really fall in love was that first feeling of like, you know, getting a little bit of air on a skateboard. You know, and then when once I got to the point, like. You know, when I started, that was right around the time when street skaters were starting to ollie.
Yeah.
So, like, you know, I'm watching, like, all the vert pros, except for, like, Tommie Guerrero and, like,
Tony Hawk,
Gons and Nodis, but, like, ollieing up curbs, like, just, you know, casually, like, as part of skating.
Like Mark Gonzalez and
especially Mark. I mean, I couldn't even fathom, like, what Mark Gonzalez was doing back then.
Yeah.
Like, it was like, you know, I had no idea how.
You're like, whoa.
Yeah, it just didn't even, it was impossible.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? But like once I could ollie
up. We try to copy it too.
See,
I grew up at Pensacola, and like we kind of like had to like, we didn't have that out here. You know, I mean, we didn't have California. We put Pensacola, Florida. So it was like kind of like, we had to like magazines and videos. So we had to copy that kind of stuff and go out and practice it and stuff like that and everything. So.
Yeah, that's interesting that you said that, because in California, like I said, like once I ventured out of my neighborhood as a skateboarder, and like went to Venice, that's when everything changed. You know, because there I'm seeing pros. Like I'm seeing like Hasoy and, you know, who else? Nodis. I used to see Nodis all the time.
Salmon. North.
Yeah.
North County.
San Jose.
San Jose, that's right.
But I'm saying the Venice, the beach skate culture.
Yeah.
You know, there was all the Z-Boys and the Alva team and, you know.
Yeah.
So I would go there and I would see all, you know, I'm there with pro skaters.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it was, I think, you know, we had a big advantage at the time in Southern California for skating. So, and that's another thing that helped me progress too, because even at a young age, I already met like sponsored and like pro skaters because they just existed in the landscape.
Who was your first pro skater?
I met?
Yeah.
Man, who was the first pro
skater? That took you under the wing and like...
Well,
not really took out a ring, but like.
Well, I think Eric Dressen might have been the first pro I met that I actually like. I should say met, because I met people like I said at Venice, but Eric was like the first dude that like I skated with, because a friend of mine that I grew up with had a ramp, and Eric, he knew Eric already, and Eric would come to skate his ramp.
Yeah.
You know, before I met him, my friend. So he already had a relationship with Eric. So I met Eric through him.
Okay.
So, it was crazy, to skate with him.
Yeah.
You know, it was insane, how good he was compared to, what we were.
Were you kind of nervous when you skated with him?
Or yeah, definitely.
You're like,
I still get that way around some people,
really?
Some pros. Oh yeah, for sure.
Damn.
There's some people that they were such big influences and I looked up to them so much. It does not matter how much I am around them. I can go on tour with them, and I'm still.
Would you sit back and kind of hold yourself okay? And then get yourself comfortable and get in there and skate with them?
Yeah.
Or would you be like,
well, I mean, there's definitely times too that like I'd want them to see how good I was as well. I want to show them hey, I'm good,
I'm reasonably sponsored too,
exactly. especially before I was sponsored.
Yeah.
I think it had a lot to do with me getting sponsored as well, because I was skating, I would go to contests and I was trying to get out there so the pros would see me skate.
Yeah.
And a lot of my friends that I skated with, I was really fortunate because I came up with a lot of people that we all became pro skaters.
Yeah.
A lot of people can't say that, because they lived in other states. You being in Florida.
Yeah.
It's only a handful of people.
Exactly.
From our era.
Yeah.
Became pro.
Yeah.
But seriously, most people that I a lot of people in my crew I skated with, pretty much all of them became sponsored.
Yeah.
And a lot of them became pros.
That's awesome.
It's a trip. But yeah. That's only because we're where we were. We were in the right place at the right time.
That's awesome. That's awesome to learn that from you, about how you became what you are
now. Yeah,
I knew
Kareem Campbell and Daniel Castillo and
And that was all from the Love Child, right?
Yeah, but I knew them. Well, I knew Kareem and Daniel before I was even sponsored.
Okay.
Before they, I think Kareem might have been sponsored. But they had both got on World, but it was still SMA. SMA
oh,
Rocco
wow.
Division.
I remember that. Yeah.
SMA World Industry. They had just got on. But
yeah.
I knew Kareem, definitely Kareem before. Because we had already skated we skated Castle together.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Shop sponsored Castle contests and stuff. So, yeah, but I'm just saying, these people all made it in the industry,
yeah.
in the sense, became pros.
Yeah.
So that's a trip, man.
And you lived in that, you were part of that whole Love Child scene. What was that like? Growing up, coming from Venice.
Well,
until
see,
all
that's
the way
something
to,
too. I knew Guy. Guy and I were friends before I was sponsored. And Guy wrote for, when I first met Guy,
was it when he wrote for
I don't even think
Blind?
He wrote for PAL yet.
Or PAL, sorry, PAL.
Yeah, I think he just wrote for Renee's.
Okay.
Renee's skate shop
okay.
on Melrose. And but he got on PAL maybe he already was on, or
it was, that
was
whole
around
LA,
that time.
LA, LA
yeah,
boys
around that
are,
time.
Yeah.
And I knew, I knew Gabriel and I knew Rudy.
Uh-huh.
Not Rudy. I met Rudy later on, a little bit later on. But I knew Gabriel and Paulo
okay.
Real early.
Yeah.
Because Rudy didn't live in L.A. at the time. Rudy, I think, had moved away to Walnut or wherever his family moved to out of L.A.
Uh-huh.
too. So, but I knew, you remember, John Erlanes and Duck Tran? They wrote for World.
Oh, I haven't heard those names in a while.
I knew those dudes. I knew those dudes,
yeah, yeah.
Before I was sponsored, too. Because that was, all the L.A. skaters.
Yeah.
Because my dad lived in Hollywood. My parents were divorced when I was young, when I was seven. So I lived back and forth. I lived mainly with my mom to go to school. But I was with my dad always, and he was in the music industry, so he was in the heart of it. He lived right off of Hollywood Boulevard. So
Hold on, your dad was in the music industry? That's awesome, dude.
Yeah. So, yeah, he was a songwriter. He, had albums.
Dude, that's awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty cool. I mean, he never really got really, really big, but.
But you still live his dream,
Yeah, definitely.
That's pretty
definitely.
Badass, dude.
Definitely, yeah. So, I mean, I would see all, that was where everybody was skating around that area, A lot of those spots that, were in, Bandis and Propaganda are all, right around that Hollywood, East Hollywood area, so.
And then that's how, you got on World. How'd you get on World?
So, it all happened really fast.
Uh-huh.
So, I got shop sponsored. I remember going to, a demo slash, shop, sponsored tryout kind of thing at Val Surf.
Okay.
And then I remember me and Jerron, that's when I first met Jerron Wilson. And then me and Jerron got on Val Surf that day. And then from there, I started entering contests under the shop sponsor category. So from there, I got on Alva.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, which
I didn't know you got on Alba. That's pretty awesome.
Yeah, that was my first sponsor, first factory sponsor.
Yeah.
So, and I got on Alba because I was friends with Anthony Oglesby.
Okay.
And he's from Long Beach as well. Yeah. And he wrote for Alba. And he kind of hooked me up with Alba. And as soon as I got on Alba, they changed the name to New School.
Okay.
Like within
like
months.
Seconds.
Yeah, it was like,
I remember,
you know,
that. I remember that.
Yeah.
I was like, wait, it's Alba, New School? What, yeah. What's going on here?
And, but I mean, I don't know. I already had my sights set on writing for World Industries, right? And so around that time when I got on Alba, Kareem and Daniel had got on, you know, on World. And so, and I always skated. I skated with Kareem a lot. Like, me and Kareem were always, you know, on the weekend.
He grew up in L.A., right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. But he lived on the west side. He was, like, more, like, west L.A. Mm. You know, but he was in the beach a lot. So, that's how I met him. I'd go skate at the beach, and, you know, he'd be there. Yeah. So, and then I started, like, staying out there. Every weekend, I'd stay with my friends out there just to be in that scene. You know what I mean? So I was skating with Kareem a lot, and we'd go to contests all the time, and I'm riding for New School. And he's riding for World. And it just kind of, I remember I was at a PAL contest. And I swear, all this stuff.
Well, was it at the warehouse?
Yeah, at the factory, skate zone, or whatever it was called. And it was a, you know, like a AM contest, one of the big AM contests, like the biggest one, Quartermaster Cup or something.
Okay, I remember that.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that.
So I was in that contest, riding for New School.
Uh-huh.
And during that contest, like at the end of the contest, I guess Rocco told Kareem, like, you know, ask Shiloh if he wants to ride for World. So at the end of the contest, you know, Kareem came up to me and was like, hey, Rocco wants to talk to you, whatever. He wants to, you know, see if you want to get on the team.
Yeah.
And I was like,
you're like hell
yeah. Hell yeah. I was like, you know what I mean?
You
like,
get to ride with your homies.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. So plus I had already, like, to me, the only companies that mattered around that time were H Street and World Industries.
Yeah.
That
was it.
Because it was like the most innovative, you know what I mean?
It was like a lot of Southern California. Because up North Cal, you had like all the Santa Cruz.
Yeah, but see,
that
was only Santa Cruz. NorCal was like, Santa Cruz was the only thing I could think of, NorCal at the time. You know?
Actually, yeah.
But then Real started shortly after. Real. Yeah. And Real kind of like, I think, put NorCal on the map for like street skating.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because before that was all Vert dudes.
Yeah.
So.
No, definitely. No, because I mean, that's awesome. I mean, because you grew
up. It wasn't, but we didn't know there was no videos to show us like about Concrete Jungle or like, you know what I mean? Like the NorCal, like, because they had the dopest dudes out there.
Oh, they did.
You know, Julian Stranger, we thought of Julian Stranger as a Venice head, because that's where, because
really?
He like lived, his mom like lived in Santa Monica or something,
uh-huh.
And that's why he wrote for SMA, because he met Nadis that way.
Okay.
But we didn't know he had a NorCal connection until that video. Actually, no, I can't say that, dude. We didn't know, because Sick Boys, there was that video, Sick Boys.
I remember that.
And that was like, we were like, dang, dude, dudes in NorCal are sick, are like dope.
Yeah.
Like, you know, they're on a whole nother. You know, they had like a way, like better style, like.
They're all thrashing. They're all like that whole.
They had like a cleaner style. Cause like in LA, the style was kind of based more around like Venice Beach culture, like Hosoi, you know what I mean? Like Jimmy's and, you know. Yeah,
like high tops and stuff like that.
Yeah, I mean, they were on the same thing up there, but I think a lot of it was too, because it's colder up there too.
Yeah.
So they're always with hoodies and, you know, like how skaters dress today is how they've always dressed in San Francisco.
And then adventure down to SoCal, because I mean, with the Love Child kind of brought that whole like.
There was some, it went back and forth. Like LA brought, you know, added a lot to, especially like when, like the early 90s when hip hop came up with skateboarding, LA did a lot of influence to, you know.
Thanks to Wu-Tang on that one.
That's a whole other thing. That's the East Coast. Now,
the East Coast had a different style.
Another dope style too. And then now everybody is coming together, and it's, you know, we got this, you know, homogenization, you know, of all these styles, which is now what's
skateboarding.
Yeah. So, yeah, I totally forgot where we were at though.
It's all good.
I was talking about coming up.
Yeah, coming up.
So naturally I was like, dropped everything, got on World. Cause that was my dream.
Yeah.
And that was it. Like I never looked back. I was already on the company I wanted to be on, and then most of my friends were already guy was on Blind already. You know.
Who else? So I mean, it was like, I mean, you had a world.
Well, Kareem, Daniel, then I met Day One. I met Day One before that.
Okay.
Like through Castle Contest.
Okay.
But then I started skating with Day One all the time. I mean, it was like people I hung out with, like were all, you know, a lot of people that I was already skating with anyway.
Yeah.
So it was just like a natural progression, you know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
So it was cool. Like that, yeah, that was.
I mean, you put like, you know, World and you guys from like, you know, New World and Love Child, you know, put skateboarding on the map for Southern California. You know what I mean? Like with that style, with that whole. Yeah, but, I mean, in my eyes.
Yeah, right, exactly. For like our generation, yeah. Probably. But I mean, but then you got to remember, like, all the LA dudes before us, you know, are the ones who really put skateboarding on the map.
Definitely.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, well, not even LA. San Diego, LA, Southern California.
Yeah.
Even Northern California. Yeah. California. Yeah. Basically.
But for our era, that was like.
Yeah, boom. Our era redefined skateboarding. Yeah. Because street skating.
Yeah, because back then there was like people weren't street skating at AR in our era. You know what I mean? They were like, that's when it started getting into it. Because you know before it was like
balls. Yeah, we were still the generation that we knew how to skate transition still, because we like vert was the thing.
Yeah.
And street skating was kind of the novelty of vert skating. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And then as street took over, we had transition skills. Because I remember like the generation after us. A lot of them couldn't even like drop in on like a mini ramp.
No, they couldn't.
It was crazy.
They couldn't.
I remember one time being blown away because I didn't realize that there was a gap in like transition skills with the next generation. I remember one time somewhere, demo or something, and I was with Paul Rodriguez, right? And I remember him like dropping in on like the mini ramp and stuff, and it looked so foreign to him. And I was like expecting him just to rip the mini ramp like he did street.
Yeah.
But you could tell like that
he was a skateboard, street skating.
Yeah, he never skated transition. Yeah. I mean, he's good now on transition, but I'm saying this is like in the beginning when he first, you know, he had already put, you know, all of his energy into street skating.
Yeah.
Which is weird. Like it was weird to me, but then if you think about it, I didn't really care about transition anymore either.
Because we were doing more street.
Yeah, but we learned our fundamentals on transition.
Yeah. Because, I mean, that's what I did. Because, I mean, like, when I grew up, it was, like, more, you know, I grew up around the vert skaters. You know, like Zorlak, like Scott Stanton, all those guys. That's where I grew up. That's where they were from in Pensacola. So, I mean, and my best, the guy that got me into skateboarding, you know, he was a vert skater. So I would go watch him vert skate vert. And then I started, he got me into watching the old PAL videos and SMA videos and all that. And then I started, like, I want to start doing street.
Yeah.
I mean, I was afraid to like, skate vert. I was like, you know.
Me too, a little bit. I remember, like, that was a big deal.
Like, I was like, it was metal, too.
Yeah, like, the first time you dropped in on a vert ramp, one of the big, to this day, like, I can still remember how nervous I was.
I was scared.
Standing at the lip, like, God, don't let me die now.
I had somebody say, you drop in a vert ramp, I'll buy you a Coke.
Yeah.
I was like, all right, boom. And that's it. I was like, where's my Coke at? Ate shit at the bottom, but I got my free Coke.
But once you like, after you dropped in, once you like, damn, what was I afraid of? Like,
exactly.
That was nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
so true. But then I was like, you know, that's when I got introduced to street and started skating street. Yeah. And, you know, do the same way you did. You know, learn off of curb cuts and, you know, all that stuff. So, I mean, it was cool, like, how our era of skateboarding to it is now. It's different. I mean, it's the same, what's your feel on that? Like, from our era to now, I mean.
It's the same in the sense of, like, street skating still dominates skateboarding. Like, skateboarding is just, like, street skating now. I mean, vert's still really big.
Yeah.
But.
It's getting back up there. I see more and more.
Well, see, that's why it's good how it is now. Because I was bummed, like, in the 90s, how vert just, like, disappeared.
Yeah.
Like, because I loved watching vert skating because it was hard to do.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Like, I have a lot of respect for people that skate.
I remember one time I was on we were on this World Plan B tour, combined tour, right? And Danny Way was on the tour with us, right? And this is when Danny Way's just a street skater. You know what I'm saying? Like nobody, you know, he's known for street skating now. Yeah. People don't even remember that he's a vert skater, really. Right? Because he's so good at street.
Yeah. I remember him skating some street.
Of course. But I remember we were in this skate park in Houston, right? And the vert ramp there. The vert ramp was like a relic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It was like the Roman Coliseum. Yeah. You're like, nobody touched it.
It had cobwebs on it. You had to like dust it off like this.
And I remember telling him like, hey, go take a run, dude. Like, oh, you're a burst skater. Go take a run. Like, and padless. And he gets up there. I remember, oh, we all walked up to the top of the ramp. We were already up there just to look at it. You know, I'm like, oh, let's drop in, whatever. And I'm like, take a run. Like, and he drops in and just like, does the most amazing vert run with no pads, right? You know what I mean?
And you're like this, like,
Holy shit, in awe. And then I remembered, it made me remember, like, dude, this is Danny Way. Like, this dude was like the best vert skater. You know what I mean? It was like him and Tony Hawk, like the most tech and like,
boom, boom, boom.
Yeah, you know what I mean? Like, it just dawned on me, like vert is sick. Like, this is amazing to watch.
Danny Way that dropped out of helicopter.
No, I mean, like, years later.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, like, it brought me back. Like, it made me remember, like, dude, Bert is really, really sick. Like, this is amazing, though, especially watching it in person, watching somebody blasting, like, airs over your head. Exactly. You know what I mean? And the power, like, just, like, whoop, when they pump, like, the power and the speed. And I'm... It makes me think, like, I was bummed that Vert died that hard. That's so bad that, like, pros, like, lost a job.
Yeah.
Like, there was dudes, super good Vert, like, pros, skaters, that were just, like, out of work.
No companies
wanted them. They were too old to really transition.
I mean, there's a few Vert skaters that are still, you know, that were like, still around. Very few.
You know who I give a lot of respect to?
Is who?
That was, you know... That transitioned to street skating. He transitioned because he was still at the birth of street skating a really good street skater. You know, he's just an all around skater.
Yeah.
But people look at him as more of a verse skater. It's Steve Caballero.
Yes, 100%.
He did some of the gnarliest stuff, dude, around the night.
And he still kills it.
Yeah.
Still kills it.
Dude, I give him so much respect.
A lot of respect for him, dude.
Yeah.
We had him on a show a couple of seasons ago, so he definitely was a great interview with him. So
he's the best, coolest guy, too.
Oh, nicest guy, dude.
Love definitely. That dude.
We talked a little bit about your past. So, what are you doing now? Like, what is Shiloh doing now?
Well, I mean, I still skate, obviously. But
by the way, I gotta skate your mini ramp one day. That thing looks nice.
Super fun.
Jose was telling me about your mini ramp.
Yeah, it's a little bigger than this. It's
little
like
bigger
4 feet.
Than?
It's okay. Like 4 feet. Tall.
4 feet. Okay.
Super fun though. But I just, you know, I still skate, but I had, you know, once you get to a certain age, even if you're still, it doesn't matter. You can't. There's no way I can keep up.
You're what, 35?
Yeah, right. No, dude, how old am I? 43?
You're about my age.
Yeah. So, but, dude, like, I had to find, I hate the term, like, get a real job, but, I mean, I had to transition into work, you know, and I hustled for so many years just trying to stay, you know, make ends meet in the skateboard industry. Not, you know, even like doing as much as I could on the skateboard end, and then I taught myself how to do graphic design like throughout the years.
Oh, you do graphic design?
Well, I don't anymore.
Oh, okay.
I mean, I still could, but I don't. I don't by profession.
Yeah.
But I was like, you know, doing freelance graphic design stuff in the skateboard industry. And then I had always been into like cars, building custom cars.
Oh, what? Sick.
Yeah, Volkswagens was my thing. Still
That's
is,
awesome.
Still is a little bit. But so from that, a friend of mine, Stacy Lowry, he was in the cars too as well, but he was into motorcycles.
Yeah.
So he got me into motorcycles. And then from him, I met other people, another friend of mine, and I started working with him, this dude named Jay LaRosa. And he has his shop grew into a pretty legit custom motorcycle shop here in Long Beach.
Yeah.
And I was doing bikes with him, like working with him at his shop. So I had already kind of stepped away from skateboarding, and I was like fully into the custom motorcycle world. And then there just wasn't a lot of money in that. You know what I mean? Like it was hard work. It's a lot of hours of like, you know, hard labor.
Yeah.
I started getting into fabricating, like, you know, just building, you know, motorcycle parts and custom stuff for like my bikes and whatever. And I miss skateboarding a lot too. So I started leaning back on trying to get graphic design jobs. And then so then I started bringing graphic design, like trying to do motorcycle stuff and skateboard. Like,
oh, wow.
Do work and like, you know.
To do what you're doing two things that you love.
Yeah, exactly.
You know?
But it was mainly out of necessity because I needed to make money. So I'm like, you know, hey, I can do this.
We're living the Cali hustle.
Yeah, for real. So I was doing that for a long time, you know. And still, I always had like, you know, I always still, you have the dream. Every skater always has a dream of that they're going to be doing something in skateboarding that they're going to be able to retire from. which is like
you can't.
It never happened.
Never happened. Yeah, dude, unless you're signed
like this, like this many people have done it.
Unless you're signed with a big corporation.
Yeah, I'm just saying, like it's.
I haven't got my big check yet. I'm still waiting on that thing.
So,
but you do it for fun. That's the main thing, you know, fun and love.
In fact, Kris Love was like, it was like really like the essence of skateboarding to me. It was like from the heart. You know what I mean? Like especially as an adult, like I'm not a teenager, like a young teenager, like Love Child, New World Order days, where I'm kind of trying to follow the trends as well. You know what I mean? You're caught up in that. And you're doing stuff, you're skating for yourself, but at the same time, you're really trying to please other people as well.
Yeah.
Like trying to stay relevant in the industry and whatever. Which, there's nothing wrong with that, but I feel like Kris Love was like, that was just me.
Yeah.
Like, I had no pressure from any direction. I didn't have a sponsor, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. I was truly skating for myself.
Yeah.
So, that, to me, like, that's my favorite video part of mine, because it was just
it's
pure.
Mine too.
It was, yeah, it, you know. And it might have not been as tech as like some of my earlier video parts, whatever, but it was like really like my soul.
To me, when I watched it, it was like, I mean, I watched it like so many times and like it was just natural.
Maybe that's why a lot of people, and I get that from a lot of people, it's really relatable to a lot of people that see that part. And that makes me feel good because it truly was that for me. Like that was really like, that was me.
Yeah.
Like, no influence, no outlet.
You had no TMs, like, oh, we got to get this.
Yeah,
nobody
like,
oh,
you got to do this trick, or you know.
Oh,
like,
wait, your shoes got to match your outfit, and this and that.
Yeah, exactly, none of that. So that's cool. I'm glad that, like, it translated like that. People see that, and they feel like, man, this is just, like, real. Like, this is just, like, you know, the essence of skateboarding.
But I think ever since, in my opinion, what I've seen is, like, I think ever since your part dropped for Kris Love, I think a lot of skaters now kind of like, not want to say copy, but kind of like flow the way you that video part. I see a lot
That's cool.
A lot of that. You know what I mean?
I mean, I don't look at that and see like that I had much influence in that. But if people think that's cool, like that's something to be proud of. Because I think that at that time, like around Kris Love, I think skateboarding got so just, it was like, nobody, there was a handful of people that like would do anything that was outside of the norm. You know what I'm saying? Like it was
I call it the cool guy club. They're all part
totally,
of
yeah, cool exactly, guy club. Exactly. That's how it was. It was like a fraternity. Like everybody, you know, everybody is either like the people that belong didn't want to let anybody in, and then everybody that was out tried their hardest to do what the people that were in it were doing, and everybody was afraid to like do anything different because there would be no way they would ever get in that fraternity.
Exactly.
And I hated that.
Oh.
I hated it.
Industry still like that.
Yeah, I know. That's one thing that sucks about skateboarding.
Yeah.
It's like that. It's like that will probably always exist.
It will always will.
Yeah, that sucks.
But they're always gonna be like you and me and everybody else. And just we don't care. We just have fun.
But like, I mean, those are the people. But it's funny, man. People just need like, I don't know. Like those are the people I like to watch. Mm-hmm. Like I can, like when I watch new videos, I get bored, dude. And these people are doing things. Like they're so good. Like Nigel Houston, for example.
Yeah.
Like he could do a ledge line, like a ledge run.
Yeah.
And every single trick he does, besides like the flat ground tricks in between, would be like my last trick. You know what I'm saying? Like in my video part.
Yeah, I didn't say
it's that good. But these dudes are so good, and their part is they bombard you with. And it's not their fault that they're that good, but they're just so good that you stop caring.
Yeah.
You're watching it and you're like, it's almost like when you first play Tony Hawk Pro Skater.
The first one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you like are stringing these crazy lines together.
You're like
of impossible tricks, and you're like, there's no way anybody would ever be able to do this line.
That's what they're doing now.
But yeah, exactly. That's real. So you watch it on that. Say it's like I can't relate. Like there's a disconnect.
Yeah.
There's like, even though I know this is real, it's like it's not real.
It's like, am I watching a video game or am I playing Tony Hawk or Thrasher? Remember Thrasher game?
So it's like, and I feel, and not only that, everybody's that good.
Yeah.
Like it's so now is like a good time where people who are doing something different stand out. Mm-hmm. You know, like when I see dudes, I can't really think of too many off the top of my head, but. That are kind of just doing their own thing. I'm like, like, put it this way, like, if I'm on, like, Instagram or YouTube or whatever, and I'm, like, following video links, and I, like, I'll see somebody that's, like, doing just interesting, cool stuff, creative stuff,
yeah.
I'm way more psyched to watch it. Like, I'll watch the whole thing. Like, I'll watch, maybe watch the part over again. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
But then, like, I'll see, like, these new super crazy video parts, and, like, I, sometimes I just can't even finish watching them. I'll click onto something else because yeah. I'm just...
There's like, I'm bored.
Yeah, and that sucks. It sucks to say that.
It's true. I mean, it's definitely true. I mean, because, I mean, I see all this stuff, and I'll watch and check out things, and it's true. It's like, I don't.
It's like, doesn't it feel weird that, like, you're even saying that about shit that's so amazing, but it's just like...
I'd rather see natural stuff.
Yeah, me too.
So just cruising down the street, just do a flip trick here, 5-0 grind here, you know, just real stuff here and there. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, I could watch Gino push down a street.
Exactly.
You
know I'd be stoked.
Watch him push just ollie up
curves. I could watch you push down the street. I'd be stoked, dude.
I appreciate it. But you know what I mean? Like, that to me, that like, style, having good style, and, like, and it's not no force good style. Just, like, I think style comes with people understanding, like, they just understand skateboarding. They understand that, like, the fundamentals of just how pure it is to, like, skate down a street.
Yeah.
Like, from point A to point B. Mm-hmm. Like, it's not about the spots. It's about just
cruising.
Yeah, just cruising and, like, skating stuff that's on the way.
Yeah.
I think that, like, that's always going to be much more enjoyable to watch.
Than watching tech stuff and everything.
Yeah, like, that GX1000 video.
Oh, my God.
See, that's something. Okay, there you go. Perfect example. Like, all the stuff I've seen for a long time, and I'm like... You know, yeah, it's amazing, but, or like, what was that other video?
There's so many of them.
Well, this is way before that, like years ago, but it was a good one. I wish I could remember the name right now. Anyway, but that's, for instance, that GX1000 video. Watching that was like, that's skating to me. Like that raw, just real, like, get up, you know, no real agenda, just like, go skate.
Yeah.
You know? Besides, like, the gnarly hill bombing, like, crazy stuff.
The San Francisco shit.
Which is, like, super...
I won't do it.
See, to me, that's entertaining to watch.
Seeing those cruising past cars and stuff like that.
You know? Blowing stop signs and lights.
I can't do it. I'll be walking down that hill.
Go, like, 40.
I'll hold my board and just walk down it. Yeah. I'll meet you downstairs.
I'll go down, but I'll, like, by the time I get to the bottom of the hill, my wheels went from, like, 55 millimeters to, like, 35. So I'm, like, it's like I might as well be snowboarding down there. I'm just, like, carving down the whole hill.
So I got one last question for you. What is the most memorable thing out of your whole skateboard career that sticks to you? The one memorable thing.
Man, that's a hard one.
I've been asking these guys because I, you know, want to know, like, what's...
But memorable, like, in what sense?
Like from the time you're skateboarding to the sponsors to now. Like, what sticks out to you that will always stick to you forever?
Man, I don't know. I've seen a lot of things. Like, I've met a lot of, like, I've met, like, almost all my heroes that I've looked up to in skateboarding. And that's always. Like I said, every time I get around, like, Ray Barbie or Matt Hensley, Jason Lee, like... You know, Mark Gonzalez, especially Mark Gonzalez. Yeah. Like, these are people, like, I skated with a lot, but it doesn't matter. Every time I see them, I'm still like, whoa. Like, I still, like, I can't help myself.
You know, well, that's how I am with you, you know what I mean?
So I know how you feel. That's so weird, though, isn't it?
I mean, I've met you before with Chef, that, but I still, like,
Even Sean, another example. Yeah. Like, I can't, because they're so amazing. Mm-hmm. And, like, they inspired me so much that... That will never go away. So that's one thing that's definitely always remember. But I think for me, one thing is a feeling that I remember, like, that I always remember is, like, probably one of the best feelings I ever had in my life, besides, like, you know, my daughter being born, was when I got on World. Just because it was something, it wasn't even getting sponsored. Because I remember when before I was sponsored, I wanted to be sponsored so bad. Like, every kid wants to be sponsored, right? Even or every kid tells himself, oh, I want to be sponsored. I want to be a pro skater, right?
Yeah.
But I was already sponsored, and I it's like almost I didn't care because I was so focused on I want to ride for World Industries. That's all I mean, it was my goal.
Yeah.
So when I got on World Industries, that was like, how I felt was like I made it. Like even more than turning pro. When I turned pro for World, it wasn't even that big of a deal to me. I kind of felt like I was like, oh, I don't even deserve to be pro. Like, you know what I mean? Like, they're just, you know... They'll turn anybody pro. That's what I kind of felt like. You know what I'm saying? But just getting sponsored, just being accepted to be a part of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Something I looked up to so much was huge. Like, that's awesome. It blew me away.
That's awesome, dude.
So, I mean, But I'm, there's so many things. There's so many, you're saying like one thing that stood out the most. It's like,
oh no, it's tough to say that.
Yeah, you know, but that to me, that's something that I will, that feeling, like I said, there's not many times in life I've felt that way.
Yeah.
Again, that to me, that was the biggest accomplishment.
I'm stoked for
that.
You,
that I've ever.
I mean you've done so much for skateboarding, man. I want to say thank you for what you have done for skateboarding, brother.
Dude, I appreciate it.
And thank you for coming on the show.
You're welcome, man.
You're definitely good, man. And I just want to say thank you for everybody tuning in to True Skateboard Mag Season 3, Episode 2. And it's out. Peace.